Members, we have formed a quorum and now call the meeting to order. The minutes of the last meeting, the meeting held on the 17th of October, have been sent to members. We haven't received any proposed amendment. If members do not object, then I'll confirm the minutes. Okay, so minutes confirmed. Information paper issues since the last meeting, there are two which are set out on the in the agenda. Please note that there is a letter from Mr. Alvin YEUNG on issues relating to the pilot scheme for installation of radio-based stations at selected government venues, and also in respect of the restricted area in the Tai Po Natural Reserve. And the government would present a paper for discussion in April or May. So please read the letters. If we don't want to wait until the April and May, the members may wish to raise further questions through the panel for more information. So if that doesn't happen, then we are going to have a discussion in April or May. Date of next meeting and items of discussion. At a meeting held on the 17th of October, members make some comments on what to discuss, and we have a meeting, the Deputy Chairman and I, and a meeting with the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, and you may wish to refer to the list of outstanding items for discussion on proposed items, and also the proposed discussion time. So please offer comments after you have read the list. The next meeting would be held on the 9th of December, is a Monday, at 2:30 p.m. in Room 3. The government proposes to discuss first annual work progress of Cyberport, and second item, public payphone review and free Wi-Fi hotspot in public telephone kiosk. Two items. Okay, I've been reminded by the clerk that we have now that we have a sufficient number of members present, we should go to discuss an item under AOB, and that is we are going to visit Cyberport and Science Park, Art Street, and Smart City Innovation Center. We have been trying to work out a suitable date. So it should be the 7th of 21st of January. And we don't have many members here, so I won't fix the date today. If necessary, we can circulate a notice to members. Or maybe we can have a discussion in the next meeting with more members present. Have a discussion in that regular meeting in December. If the members have no further comments, then we'll make the two visits to that two institutions. Because we're talking about two different locations, Science Park and Cyberport. So apart from these are two labs and an innovation center, we may wish to explore whether we can also visit other facilities there. This will be fixed later. Oh yes, I have to put a question to you. If members do not object, we will invite the media to cover the visit. Any objection? No? Okay. If there's no further point to raise here, we would fix the date. Later on, let's proceed to the first discussion item. Please invite the ITB officials to join us. First item, Capital Works Reserve Fund, HAT 710, computerization subhead A, 007GX, block allocation, new administrative computer systems, 2020-2021 estimates of expenditure.
咁我哋有中副局長同埋
We have Mr. Chung and Mr. Lam. So, Undersecretary. I have to remind members in respect of declaration of interest. I think you are all familiar with this. According to the 83 roof 83A or 84, if you are direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please declare your interest, the nature of interest before you speak. Undersecretary, Chairman, every year we would seek a Finance Committee's approval so that under the Capital Works Reserve Fund HAT 710 computerization, broad allocation, we would seek an allocation. We propose $1.3 billion, an increase of $180 million over 2018-2019 or 16%, so as to launch 900 IT-related projects, including 200 new projects to be rolled out next year. From 2021, under the broad allocation, the number of the expenditure is expected to reach a 10-year high. With the digital transformation, many departments have increasing needs for IT technology. In the resource allocation exercise, we have registered a 16% increase in funding application. So the total allocation in 2020-2021 will also reach a new high. Different departments would take forward different IT projects so as to enhance their efficiency of their work and to enhance security of the service. There are five different categories, such as implementation of e-government strategy, government's information, robotics, and improvement to security of services, and to tie in with our initiative to develop a smart city. Many technology and new technology will be needed to enhance government efficiency and public service, such as robotic technology can be utilized to provide better user experience, and also enhance cloud service can improve the efficiency and functions of the IT system. Enhancing the strengthening IT security is also one of the major tasks that we have to carry out. The different bureaus and departments continue to carry out assessments and implement measures to strengthen IT measures to and guard against security threats and cyber attacks on government IT system. We urge members to support this broad allocation application. We are happy to answer members' questions. Would the GICO be answering or like to say something or just answer questions? Okay, we have a number of members who would like to ask questions. Mr. Ma Feng Kuo, or Mr. Chen Ying. 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I have a question about expenditure. In Annex A, we are given different categories, hardware, software, contract staff, contingency. The contingency fee has gone up by 19%, which is higher than other categories of expenditure. Contingency is what it suggests is for something you cannot really forecast. So what about others? The increase is 23%. What is this for? Why is it that it has registered the highest rate of growth among all the categories of expenditure? And also paragraph 8 states, that the government is using the Hong Kong MA system and the transfer system for payment of rates, water tariff, and in the future, LCSD fees and charges, license fees, and the customs and excise department charges and fees. How many government services are not yet covered by the FPS, and do you have a timetable for the application of FPS to these payments? And you want to talk about the blueprint of the smart city. And then you said that there were 70 projects to be carried out by departments to enhance operational efficiency. Earlier, FSTB said that for the rebate of rates, there will be a smart system for those who own multiple properties. But I've seen nothing further from the FSTB. Do you have a plan to connect different government IT systems for the departments concerned? Do you have a timetable? On the question of contingency, the rate of increase is big because the base figure is small. So it's from 71 million to 85. So just increasing 1 million would mean a few percentage of increase. Actually, the actual increase is more or less in line with other categories.
基本上那個增幅是相
so actually the increase is comparable with other categories because it's a sort of a fixed cost, so the increase is fixed in that sense. As for others, it will cover things such as site preparation. You have to carry out improvement works at some sites for the laying of telephone lines and cables. It's difficult to control the increase. And again, the base figure is small. It's from 52 to 64. So it's an increase of $12 million. It's not a big sum. The biggest increase, if you look at the list, is the implementation services. We are spending less on buying hardware and software. We're using more cloud services and other services. And so there will be a bigger increase in 2020-2021. The second question is about FPS. We are using QR code to effect FPS. We have to find out how well it is received after implementation. If the reception is good, we'll continue to extend this to other government services. So far, we don't have a timetable. But for counter services, we are going to use FPS as well. For example, LCSD collect fees and charges at its counters. And at the counters, FPS can be used. And in the early half next year, we're going to cover counter fee payments with FPS. And some bureaus have connections between different IT systems. We attach importance to this connection service to do a better job. In the OGCIO, we have launched some infrastructure services such as cloud platform. Cloud platform can be used to connect different departments. And we also, what we use to be called EID, And now it's called by another name, a convenient connection system for different departments.
And that will convenience the citizens in using government services. Are you happy with the answer? Ms. Claudia Mo. Well, there's indeed a mockery. Hong Kong, Kowloon, and the New Territories, there is smoke everywhere, and we're now discussing technology, and the government is going all out to clamp down on information freedom, or freedom of information. Now, you've lost a lot of voters' information, so do you just leave them alone? And also 12,000 applications for the $4,000 handouts have been lost. So will you just leave them as they are? Why can't that be computerized? How are you going to deal with that? Now you will have $1.3 billion in a block grant. Are you going to provide personal service? That's a mockery. How ironic it is. Among the $1.3 billion, how much is about facial identification? And how many government departments, of course, including the police, have been using facial identification technology? And how many pieces of facilities, including the smart lamp posts, have been deployed with facial recognition technology? Well, with regard to IT security, we have less incidents this year. As for the electoral office, loss of information, there was a system review. Well, he doesn't need to repeat this. Just answer my question on facial recognition. How many government departments have used that technology now? And do you have any breakdown concerning the $1.3 billion? And what departments have used such technology? The smart telephone, smart lampposts do not have facial recognition technology. Will that be used in the future? There is no intention to use that in the future. It is the smart lampposts are only for smart city. What? How many are related? How many items are related to facial recognition? Concerning the new systems, 267, there is none which includes facial recognition. The Immigration Department has made use of facial recognition for many years. They have complied with the privacy ordinance. What about the police? Well, I'm not quite sure about that. As far as the police is concerned, I have no data in hand. Yes or no? I don't need data. Yes or no? I have no information in hand. So you are completely in the dark. Yes or no? I don't know. That's the end of the answer. Well, you may refer to the answer of to my written question. They have answered all the on all government departments except the police. If the OCGIO doesn't have that, then I give the floor to the next member, Ms. Yeung. Yes, there is smoke everywhere outside, so the chairman should care about the safety of members and also the staff members. And we also cancelled our meeting at 4:30. If there is a danger, if there is danger, will we end our meeting earlier? Well, let me turn to the REO. Three items under the REO for updating the web, improving their services, making assessment. And also, some ward offices of members were vandalized, and they called the REO, and nobody answered the phone. As for 1823, the telephone number, Under the enhancement, efficiency enhancement unit, they got a lot of money concerning expanding the robotics for 1823, and whether it can deal with emergency, of course not. One may call 1823, and then it is referred to other departments to deal with the situation. I just want to ask, during an emergency, can that be used and can that be strengthened? As for the second question concerning e-holidays, I've noticed that there are 24 items and they get about $40,000 and is spread among different government departments. Why can't there be a centralized system for each department? Why each department has different time frame for handling e-leave? Is it efficient or is it a waste of money? All right, I will keep an eye on whether the clerk will ask us to make some special arrangements, and if there is any special arrangement by the secretariat, I will inform you. Yes, the OGCIO. First, concerning the emergency systems, and there are different types of emergencies. One is by using 1823 or 1823. This is most convenient if somebody wants to get a department to follow a certain case up. Dialing 1823 is one way to deal with an emergency situation. And then the efficiency unit is updating it, the system, and they are going to introduce the chatbot or expand the chatbot to deal with inquiries. As for the CSB, Mr. Wong will answer the question. Thank you, Chairman. The CSB provides a standard e-leave system, and each department has a different duty pattern, and the actual leave arrangement is different from department to department. After they've got the software, they will fine-tune the e-leave system and do some customization. Each department is different to a certain extent. It is difficult to have a one-size-fits-all software. Different departments can put their e-leave system on the cloud service of the government. So it is centralized to a certain extent, and that will enhance efficiency. Any further question? Yes. Can I say something on cloud? Yes, cloud service. You can have development or through the cloud service. You don't need customization for each department. Why don't you have a centralized cloud service for that e-leave system? Chairman, a simple reply is that basically it is centrally developed and designed. It's already been done in this regard. But each department has its own uniqueness in terms of the leave system. So after a centrally developed and designed and developed system, the departments still need to have their own e-leave system, and then their systems are put on the cloud. Maybe you can ask the CSB to standardize everything. Next, Mr. Yu Xiweng. Yes, I want to ask for supplementary information. I've heard that many government departments complaining that the hardware is out of date. So it seems that there is no money for hardware. Now, can you have a depreciation arrangement, say within how many years, and depreciation has reached its final end, And then they will have to ask for money, say, for example, 1 year before that. So will you establish a mechanism for hardware replacement? Well, Hong Kong is a very advanced city, and the hardware and software is outdated, and that's ridiculous. So will you have the replacement program? Now, you've asked the departments to make use of cloud technology and robotics. People varies, and departments also varies in terms of the use of technology. Will you provide adequate consultation so that they can make use of the latest technology? And the users only consider their own interests, and they may not consider using technology to reduce manpower or enhance efficiency further. So will you provide any consultancy or advisory service? Well, the OGCIO has been working that through various channels. We have seminars and workshops to provide information to the departments. And the IT officers have to understand the latest trend. We talk about ABCD, artificial intelligence, B, blockchain, C, cloud, D, data, big data. These are all important, and we are providing information to the IT offices. In the intranet, we also disseminate information on software and also the expiry date of those software pieces. And the departments have to prepare for replacement before the shelf life, the end of shelf life. And we also talk to the contractors in respect of replacing hardware and software, and there should be adequate conversion and also interfacing. There are 1,600-odd systems in the government departments, and in terms of hardware, and 8,000-odd software products, 50% of the software products will not have any support service in the coming 3 years, and 90% of departments have already formulated plans to replace the softwares. And about 9% of the departments have not compiled a plan, and we will work with those departments so that they can replace the software in time. Mr. Yeo also asked whether we have workshops and seminars to help the departments to make use of new technology. We certainly have. In terms of hardware, it's very simple. After a certain period of time, the hardware will become old. So do you have a mechanism? Say, after so many years, even if you don't apply, I will force you to replace hardware. Chairman, there are different types of hardware, and they have different shelf lives. And for ordinary computers, 5 to 7 years, the departments will have to replace the hardware. And in fact, many departments are replacing computers within this life span. As for bigger size computers, they may have a lifespan of 7 to 10 years, and usually the departments will replace their systems within this lifespan. Mr. Yeo asked whether there is a fixed rule. Say, for example, you have to replace the computers of the front line or at the counter within certain years. I think the most important thing is to be cost effective. And it's quite a lot of money for replacing hardware. If the department is of the view that it's cost effective to replace the hardware, then it will be done. But if the software is not outdated, then they can also ask us to replace the hardware without the software.
他們所建議的是否真的符合
So we look at that proposal to assure cost effectiveness and whether the service can be enhanced. Mr. Ma Fenghuang, this paper from the government tells us that some departments have adopted the FPS system of Hong Kong MA. Some invoice and bills will have the QR code for payment through the FPS. And also for the fifth generation driving license and vehicle license fees and charges would be covered. What about other departments? Because I think it's more convenient, so the sooner the better. And you said that you have to first of all assess the how well the public accept this. What do you have to do with this? Actually, it's the sooner the better. The more straightforward, the better. You don't have to consider their response. They can still stick to the conventional payment system. If they don't want to use it, it's a problem with your system, not a problem with the payer. People can use different e-channels to pay to effect payment, such as e-banking payments or credit card payment or PPS or even electronic and recently FPS. We are making available a number of ways for people to make payments. And some are using Apple Pay and even Google Pay. Payments can be made through all these channels. So there are many choices. So it's up to the people to decide which methods are more convenient to them. If we have to make available all payment methods to everyone, we need to modify our system, and it's quite costly. So we have to consider whether it's good value for money. We have recently covered tax payment, rates, and water tariff under FPS. It's easier because all we need to do is to just print the QR code on the bill. And the transport department also receive payments through their counters, so is the immigration department. We think if FPS can also be made available at their counters, it will be welcome. So they would have go first, so that the convenience service is made available right away now. As for other departments, we would explore different options. The point is, if a payment method is not extensively used, although it's available, then it may not be cost effective. So we need to consider this point, whether there are already sufficient payment channels, electronic payment channels for the public. So in other words, the departments will have to gauge the response before of those departments concerned before they consider joining the system. Well, we cover rates, water, bills, and tax. If many people use the FPS payment system for this department, we'll try to extend the coverage to other departments. Follow-up question? No? All right. I have some questions, some follow-up questions. Oh, yes. Do we need to ask members to endorse the funding proposal? Well, we still have to give our endorsement to your funding proposal to be submitted to the PWSC. Of course, they didn't say the members didn't say they object. Well, you have more than 200 projects for 2020, 2021. What about previous projects? 128 for the year 2019-2020, which have already been launched. You have previously provided a list to us. Would it be possible to give us a list in due course to tell us the progress? Can you do this before you proceed to the PWSC, or can you provide the information to the PWSC, Chairman? Well, on a quarterly basis, we would upload the information on the approved projects to our website. We'll upload that to our website. And if necessary, we can provide a list to the panel as well. Yes, some members would like to get prepared for your PWSC item. Some may have want to raise questions, and I think a written reply would be good enough. Some members are concerned about facial recognition technology and privacy issues. Mr. Lab, you have been talking about the different rules and standards. Well, you have many projects, but maybe you can't say anything. If you have the four factors A, B, C, D, can you tell us which one would concern these four factors, four issues, such as whether blockchain is used? I don't think many projects would use blockchain technology, but would you tell us which projects will use this technology? Similarly, for AI, not counting face recognition technology, would AI be applied in some of these projects? Can you tell us which one would use this technology or would likely use this technology? But for CD, well, cloud is used in many projects, and open data would also be relevant to many projects. Maybe you can use some ticks to tell us whether for a particular project, two or three of the technologies will be used. Sometimes we can only tell which technology will be used at the implementation stage. For example, blockchain at this stage, or we may not have made a final decision yet. Of course, we know that, for example, cloud computing, is that something we're sure? Actually, virtually all departments will have to use cloud computing. As for big data and open data, we can tell initially which projects would be relevant to big data or AI. But we'll find a way to provide the information requested by members, and that is given the technology as it stands, whether we are going to adopt the technology. But we cannot be exhaustive, so you may be able to tell us the partial picture. I think this is not just a question about funding consideration, but we need to get some data to understand how well the government has been doing in adopting the ABCD technologies. The information in this regard can tell us which service is utilized and to what extent. For example, the blockchain is used for that much in the overall situation, and how can we expect more to be covered next year? Well, that's a very valid question. As the GCIO has said, well, among the 267 projects, we have used a lot. We have used chatbot for a lot of them, but we cannot adopt a new technology for the sake of doing it. It depends on, well, as the GCIO has said, we have to look at the cost effectiveness. The same goes for blockchain. There are many applications under blockchain, and we have to assess the tendering exercise and see how the quoted bits are like. And then we'll come back to share with members on our view about certain technology, because technology is changing very rapidly. So while we want to promote technology, we have to consider what technology should be adopted. Maybe I can make a suggestion here. Every year, we'll come back to report on the progress of e-government. So under this progress report on e-government, we can say something about the adoption of different technologies and the progress as well. That's fine. And before you proceed to the PWSC, can you tell us something about these projects? Some members may be interested to know about things such as whether any of these projects will have to do with personal data, and then you have to conduct privacy assessment. For example, there is this project, eLib system, and some would involve collection of personal data. Can you also tell us that you are going to conduct some assessment in respect of certain projects to ensure that the risks will be monitored? Sometimes the departments would do what they want, but there may be problems arising out of the technology. So perhaps you should conduct some assessment on some of the systems adopted. Is there a rule that whenever personal data are involved, there will be an assessment? If we're talking about personal data of citizens, yes, we need to conduct a privacy assessment before the service can be implemented. You ask out of the 267 projects, how many of them would involve personal data of citizens, and as a result, we need to conduct privacy assessments. We can provide the information, supplementary information, to the panel later. I've noticed you have many 9.8, not 9.9 million, more than 30 out of the 260-odd. Many of them are up to $9.8 million, but there's no 9.9 million. No project would cost $9.9 million. Perhaps you should explain. I'm not saying that you intentionally keep the figure at that level. I see some would cost 0.7. There are 267 projects, more than 10% of them. Or if you count 9.6, 9.7, I would say 10 to 15% will reach the cap. That is no project should cost more than $10 million. How can you make sure that these projects under this system will not be designed in such a way that they will be covered by the block allocation up to the maximum allowed?
And there is a need to ensure quality of the project. And you also need to enable us to consider the details. To enable us to scrutinize the details. Now, Chairman, looking at the distribution, it is not uneven. One-third are projects less than $4 million, $400 to $8 million, $4 million to $8 million, about 30%, and then about $8 million, one-third. So the distribution is rather even. As for projects nearly $10 million, will there be any cost overrun? Well, if it touches $10 million, then it is beyond our authority, and therefore there cannot be any cost overrun. For those projects, they are closer to the cap of $10 million. They will have to report to us every 3 months on the expenditure situation. And if there is any discrepancy in terms of spending, then the department will have to follow up. And if there is any savings, then they will have to give up their savings for other projects. And in approving a project, we scrutinize whether the use of resources is reasonable. Otherwise, we will not approve the project. Say, for example, the project claims that it costs $9.8 million, but we check that it should take $20 or $30 million, then we will not approve that. And if there is any cost overrun, we will not allow that. There is no other member present. And no one is against the paper, as far as I've heard from what members have said. So the panel supports the proposal in principle. Have you issued any SMS to members? If members of the panel are present in this building, then I would ask members to come back to the meeting. I want to scrap the meeting now. Let us invite the officials for item 5 to come into the room. And then I would also like to urge members of my panel to come back to the meeting chamber. Right, may I welcome the secretary and also his colleagues. I will not read out their names one by one. I give the floor to the secretary, and I know that you have a PowerPoint presentation. Well, let's just say a few words and then my colleague will make the presentation. In 2017, in the policy address, we said that we would conduct a review on broadcasting and telecommunication. And you all know that the broadcasting ordinance review has been completed. As for the review of the TO, we also have a review, and we have also received some preliminary views, and therefore we would like to explain to you the views collected during the review, and also what are the changes we want to make. And then in doing so, we will complete the whole review and revamping of the regulatory regime of the transport ordinance, telecommunication ordinance, and broadcasting ordinance. My colleague will give you a PowerPoint presentation. Thank you, Chairman. Let me give you a briefing on the review of the telecommunications regulatory framework and then the way forward. In the consultation, we received 26 submissions, and they come from the licensees, the trade organizations, statutory bodies, political parties, and also LegCo members, and also statutory bodies, public utilities. Basically, they support our view, and they have also give their comments. They have given their views on the details of the four recommendations, and they have given us very valuable views, and I'll go over them with you. And they have also given other suggestions for the future development of the industry. First, let me speak on the four legislative proposals. The first is the regulation of telecommunication functions of devices under 5G and IoT era. The regulation will focus on 5G and IoT era telecommunication functions of devices that includes integrity of the structure and compatibility and also non-ionizing functions. As for material safety and the like, they will be regulated by other related laws. As for the views collected, those who gave submission support this. The second proposal is enhanced protection of underground telecommunications. We propose anyone failing to undertake pre-work pressure works, precautionary measures, or measures during road works to prevent damage to underground telecommunication lines will be made legally liable, and we propose a level 4 fine and imprisonment 6 months. And if failures result in suspension of telecommunication services, then the fine will be $200,000 and imprisonment of 12 months. And if it is a continuing offense, the additional fine will be $10,000 per day. There will be guidelines issued by the CA with regard to handling works. If the contractors comply with the guidelines, that will be a defense. On these proposals, most of the licensees support that, but we also receive some concerns by the construction sector. There are several areas of concern. First, under the new offenses, what will be the liability of the contractors and construction contractors, and also actual operational arrangements? We are now drafting the guidelines, and we'll make reference to relevant manuals and guidelines for protecting gas pipes and cables, and we'll consult the industry to follow the matter up. And then the third proposal is to simplify the issue of non-carrier licenses. Now, in the simplified arrangement, then the SCED, through publishing in the Gazette, will specify the non-carrier licenses. The merit is that we don't need to amend the TO Schedule 1. Instead, by Gazette, we will deal with that arrangement. As for the views received, some of the carrier licensees commented that there are similarities between carrier and non-carrier licenses, so the demarcation of responsibilities may not be very clear. In the new arrangement, we point out that we will deal with new services under 5G and IoT. And the licenses in the Gazette by the SED, they cover a smaller area. And then we will fully consult the stakeholders and maintain communication so that they understand the operation of the whole mechanism. And also the fourth proposal is that we are going to improve the appeal mechanism. Under the TO That is an appeal board which deals with 7Q. We propose to expand the area of appeal to deal with the decision of the CA so as to provide a more efficient appeal channel. A majority of stakeholders support our proposal. In the public consultation period, we have received other views, which are also very very valuable, and that is to facilitate the trade. The first one is to facilitate network rollout by telecommunications operators. At present, there is a mechanism for mobile network operators to seek the CA's authorization to enter land to install radio communication solutions to provide radio communication services to public places. But some stakeholders express the view that the present mechanism is not effective. They are of the view that long time is required to reach an agreement with landlords, and sometimes the landlords may have unreasonable conditions. And under the present mechanism, if there is an alternative for an installation, then it is hard to require a particular landlord to provide the space for the installation of the telecommunication equipment. Our view is that at present, the government has rolled out measures to facilitate the installation of networks. In March, we rolled out a pilot scheme providing about 1,000 suitable government premises operators to install RBS under streamlined procedures. And we will adopt a demand-led model to help the operators to apply for government venues to install RBS. We also encourage operators to negotiate with landlords. We want to point out that if we are to amend the law further, that will be an issue of private property rights, and we have to consider the necessity to balance the interest of different parties. We need to respect private rights, and we have to consider whether private owners want to use their own property for public telecommunication service. It is rather controversial, and we need to get a bigger consensus in order to plan our way forward. The second proposal is in respect of facilitating telecommunications operators to open up and use customer information. That is the general condition 7 for carrier licenses, licensees. Customer information can be disclosed to third parties under certain with the consent of customers. But this must be related to the license, use of the license. Now, there is a proposal to abolish GC7, and in the disclosure of information, this anonymous customer information, customer data can be released. We want to point out that GC7 is to protect customer privacy. Customers are concerned that their personal information, including their real-time location, will be disclosed, and therefore undermining their privacy. The data belongs to the customer and the operator, and in disclosing information, we need to consider the operator's view and whether they are willing to do it free of charge without any consensus, so we should not embark on this. The third area is this. Under the TO, there is a need for licensees to adopt certain accounting practices under the accounting manual, and it is too complicated, and they ask for simplification. We want to point out that the requirement generally is in line with accounting principles. The licensees have to adopt certain measures. to provide suitable information to the CA for regulatory purposes.
That said, we review the financial information required for reporting by licensee under the accounting manual system and consider whether there is room for streamlining. There's another suggestion to streamline the requirement for licensee to publish their tariffs. They think that this, given the present day situation, this is not very meaningful because the licensees are only allowed to publish their tariffs and they are not supposed to charge anything above the tariffs. But given the current market practices, usually there will be promotion packages and concessions. Well, the CA would consider whether we can exempt licensees to submit tariffs to the CA and whether there's a streamlined arrangement for publishing tariffs. Another suggestion is to help the sector to remove the requirement to file copies of interconnection agreements with the CA. Under the current TA, there will be the need to submit a copy within 14 days, and the licensee has to delete sensitive information from the interconnection agreements before submission. This is time-consuming. But this is under Section 36A. There is a reason why we need to do this. We cannot just delete this requirement. But that said, we considered allowing licensees to provide international templates with such information in lieu of the obligation to submit copies of individual agreements to facilitate the submission process. With regard to these recommendations and proposals, if there's a wide public consensus, we proceed with the legislative amendments. As for some others, proposals and recommendations, we will keep them under review. Chairman, maybe I can supplement. So basically, we proposed a framework for the public consultation last year. This is for a number of objectives. The advent of new technology, 5G, we need to facilitate the promotion of 5G. And also to protect the transmission of 5G in the system. We're not just talking about enhancing security of telecommunication. 5G can be used for some other purposes as well. And we have talked to the sector. They generally welcome the proposals. As for other proposals that require further consultation, we would pursue those in due course. So basically, that's the preferred direction. And for changes that require legislative amendments, we would table them in this council in due course for members' consideration. Well, the atmosphere outside is quite tense, and these proposals are not considered controversial. But for me, I've heard some views from companies and stakeholders, but they don't think the proposals are controversial. Some of them are what they have been asking for some time. And some of the proposals will not carry implications that they would see immediately, such as 5G devices. Because many of them, the future trend is not yet very clear, but they generally support the proposals. As the Bureau has said, well, technology has been changing very rapidly, has been advancing in leaps and bounds. If there are minor adjustments required, I hope you will be flexible in your approach, because some of the new technology have yet to come on stream. And the stakeholders have been asking for infrastructure to be provided, and you are going to consult the sector again on the guidelines. So you have completed the consultation on legislative amendments, but what about the consultation with regard to the guidelines? Are you going to wait for the amendments to be passed first, or are you going to do it now? Well, the sector, the stakeholders generally support the proposals. As I've said, 5G commercial applications are about to be launched in the market, so we need to have the right legal framework to facilitate the development. If there's a need during the legislative amendment exercise to do some refinement and amendments, we would do them in a pragmatic manner. And as for protection of infrastructure, we'd like to see the law, the legal framework in place ASAP. As for the guidelines for the construction industry, we're going to work in parallel on those guidelines. Because if you ask them to shoulder some responsibilities, they need to know exactly what they are, and also their liabilities in case of non-compliance. So we need to draft the guidelines to tell them what their obligation, where their obligations lie when the new law becomes effective. I would like to make sure that the stakeholders and the relevant sector and industry knows what they are supposed to be responsible for when the new law is ready. So all the stakeholders and industries would be consulted, I gather. Well, the guidelines would cover responsibility of telecommunication operators, such as in terms of excavation, and also the provision of information of underground cabling, the layout, etc. Well, they know very well about the relevant issues involved here, such as the power supply, etc. So both sides should have a clear understanding on what is required on either side. We hope that when the new law is ready, we have the support of both industries. We are also going to open up telecommunication data, where I subscribe to the views in the paper that many people are concerned about real-time data on personal information or location. These are sensitive, and they may not have a lot of confidence, even if it's regulated under the PDPO, because the protection is very limited. I think that's the need to balance, and there's no consensus. Balance different requirements. If the telecommunication operator can make use of the data they have collected, or even to sell the data, well, you should first of all look at the international trend, so that the needs of various parties can be satisfied. I don't think it's the right time to make the data available now. And I now turn to something which may or may not be directly relevant to the regulatory framework. And we want to talk about freedom. We want to ensure protection of freedom of communication. I've received a letter from the CEE in early October. I wrote to her to seek her assurance on of freedom of communication, because the fact that the emergency regulation ordinance was invoked. The reply is positive in certain aspects. She talks about the core value of freedom of telecommunication, and we have to be very careful if anything that we do should interfere with freedom of information. The letter is dated the 8th of November, and it's already 11th of November. It said that there's no plan to come up with new regulations further to what the government has done. And then the public interest will always be at the very forefront of government policy decision. I think many people like me are adamant that we should do everything we can to protect freedom of information. If we have anything in the nature of prohibition of internet communication, we are going to suffer from grave consequences. And now you have the emergency regulation invoked, whether the TO, telecommunication ordinance is to be amended or not. There are many things done under the emergency regulation that will be out of our control. I hope you would like us do everything we need to safeguard our freedom of communication, especially through the internet. This is very important to our economy, to our society, our financial sector, etc. Chairman, with regard to your first question, do we need the ISP? Are we going to require the ISP to share the big data that they have collected? Well, we have had some opportunities to exchange views. First of all, this issue is not within the purview of the current review, but now, in the big data era, the data would have economic value or commercial value. But as the chairman has rightly pointed out, we need to balance this opportunity with privacy concerns. So this will be for the long run. This is not something to be covered by the proposed legislative amendments. And you have carefully referred to the reply that you have received from the CEE. I believe the government's response is clearly reflected by what you have just referred to. I have nothing to add to that. On the review of telecommunication regulatory framework, I think so. No other members would like to offer further comments at this stage. So the next stage is for the legislative amendment. Is there a need to come back to this panel? No. So you just queue up for the new amendments to be considered in LegCo, right? Well, we don't have anything under AOB. The next meeting will be held at the 9th of December, 9:30 a.m. So meeting's adjourned. Thank you.